open the history book of West Virginia basketball, and faces come to mind. Thorne, Hundley, West. Some of the names that propelled this program into the annals of national prominence. Today, that tradition continues under a man who has the uncanny ability to mold a rudderless group of young men into a team of dynamic proportion. In 1988-89, Gale Catlett transformed a band of talented individuals into a well-oiled machine that ripped through opponents on the way to a top 20 finish and yet another winning appearance in the NCAA tournament. This was a team that earned 26 victories against only 5 defeats. And it was a team that earned its page in the history book of West Virginia basketball. It is a glorious volume filled with accomplishments that were built upon a tradition of excellence. The WVU basketball highlights are sponsored by Key Centurion Bankshares. Fortunately, perhaps, the low point of this campaign came in the very first game. Tiny Robert Morris College came to Morgantown for the season opener and shocked the Mountaineers by leaving with an 8-point win. Senior co-captain Darryl Prue led WVU with 15 points and 13 rebounds. Fellow captain Herbie Brooks added 15 points as well. But these two leaders were floored by the loss.
Robert Morris lost. It really, you know, it shocked us coming in. We were expecting to have a really good year, and to have such a letdown the first game here at home, it was devastating to us. And we had a team meeting. Prue and myself orchestrated it after that game, and we brought a lot of personal things out on and off the court. And I think after that game, we became much closer on and off the court.
West Virginia rebounded with a 4-point win over Fresno State. Junior guard Steve Berger pumped in 15 points. Freshman Chris Leonard added a spark off the bench with some deadly 3-point shooting. But 2 days later, Bradley came to town and pulled away in the second half for a narrow 2-point win. Junior forward Chris Brooks added 15 points, and Prue scored just 1 point less. But still, the Mountaineers came up short. In retrospect, it would be an insignificant loss because West Virginia would not lose another basketball game in nearly 3 months. After a win over Mount St. Mary's, the Mountaineers rolled into Pittsburgh to do battle with the highly regarded Pitt Panthers. Herbie Brooks poured in 26 points to give WVU a hard-fought overtime win in Fitzgerald Fieldhouse. The front court duo of Prue and Big Brooks totaled 27 points between them, with some smashing inside play. Steve Berger stroked in a dozen points, and Wade Smith, perhaps the most improved player on this squad, added 12 in a sparkling effort. It was a colossal win for West Virginia, but it was only the second victory in what would become an incredible 22-game winning streak.
The win at Pitt, it was very special for me. My last opportunity to go up there and play and to beat those guys up there, and the Big East team especially, you know, it really felt good. And that was one of the games that started the win streak for us, you know. That was in the midst of it, and that was a really big win for us.
Memories like the corners of my mind, misty watercolor memories of the way we were.
Saturday, December 17th was an extraordinary day for West Virginia basketball. The Virginia Tech Hokies were in town that day, but more importantly, dozens of former players were present to relive old memories and pay tribute to one of the greatest players the game has ever seen, Jerry West. This is what tradition is all about at West Virginia University.
Well, I told the players in the locker room before the game that this university has great tradition, as they already know, but to watch the former players walk across that court and be introduced and the pride with which they walked out there, I think fired our team up for this Virginia Tech game. And our guys went out and just did a heck of a job that day.
The Mountaineers took the floor that day and dominated the Hokies from start to finish. A dozen West Virginia players cracked the scoring column on the way to a 49-point rout of Virginia Tech. Darryl Prue led the way with 17 points and 11 rebounds. Herbie added 16 points with his steady backcourt play. Freshman sensation Tracy Shelton tossed in 13 as the Mountaineers continued to ramble over their non-conference opponents. Next in line was a tough overtime win at UNC Charlotte. Four starters hit for double figures in this 9-point victory. Steve Berger led the assault with a 20-point effort. Darryl Prue went 8-for-9 from the field to rack up 16. Next, WVU traveled to Cole Fieldhouse to take on Maryland. Chris Brooks stepped forward and slammed home 19 points to give the Mountaineers a sweet win over this Atlantic Coast Conference club. Back on another win at UMass, and yet another at St. Bonaventure in the Coliseum. Ray Foster, who had filled a void at the center position, came through for 14 points against the Bonnies. The next victim was Duquesne. West Virginia's stifling defense set up a running game that overwhelmed the Dukes. WVU topped the century mark for the second time in the 29-point win over this Atlantic 10 foe. St. Joseph's fell next in Philadelphia. Herbie and Chris Brooks teamed up for 35 points in this victory over the Hawks. The winning streak seemed to be taking on a life of its own, but it took equal parts of desire and determination to keep it alive.
I think it started from day one, and it carried on during the year because we had something going into the year. We said we wasn't going to have the year we had last year. And, you know, everybody worked hard, and we had somebody in every position to push somebody. So that made everything that much easier, and we wanted to win. So we went out to do it.
The streak stretched to 10 with a win over Rutgers in Morgantown. Herbie Brooks led all scorers with 20 points, and West Virginia forced 27 turnovers with some tenacious defense. This team was one of the best defensive clubs in school history and ranked among the leaders nationally all season long. George Washington fell next, but not by much, as West Virginia passed a stern test with a tight 2-point victory in D.C. Five Mountaineers scored in double figures in this down-to-the-wire win. That set up a grudge match against the Temple Owls. With a sold-out Coliseum and a national television audience looking on, West Virginia was not about to give up the longest winning streak in America, especially not to Temple. The Mountaineers raced out to a 21-7 lead over the shell-shocked Owls. Steve Berger led the charge with 19 points as WVU passed this test with flying colors. Halfway through the season, the 13-2 Mountaineers were in first place in the Atlantic 10 Conference and coming hard down the backstretch.
The great crowd we had for the Temple game was certainly instrumental in our big win here. And I think that was really important for us because we had to play them again back on their home court. They had been number one in the nation the previous year, and we wanted to win the championship. We wanted to go through the league undefeated, and we couldn't do that unless we defeated Temple on our home court, and our guys did a great job that day.
George Washington invaded Morgantown next, and WVU gained the measure of revenge for the tight game in D.C. Four Mountaineers scored in double figures in this 35-point rout of the Colonials. Next, West Virginia traveled to Pittsburgh for a rematch with Duquesne in the new A.J. Palumbo Center. This game was a dogfight in the early going until Tracy Shelton stroked three consecutive three-pointers to jumpstart the Mountaineers to a 16-point win.
The coach was telling me that get in the game and shoot the ball because the three-pointer was open because they was keying so much on our big people. And I thought once I got in the game, they left me open and I had chances to knock it down and luckily they was falling in for me.
Next was another road trip and another victory, this time at the expense of the Rhode Island Rams. Steve Berger led the balanced attack with 19 points. Chris and Herbie Brooks teamed up for 30 points as West Virginia overcame a tie ball game at the half to win by 8. The road trip continued with the Mountaineers running into a buzzsaw at Rutgers, but escaping with a 2-point win. The Scarlet Knights shut down the WVU front court. However, Berger and Brooks countered that strategy with a furious charge from the outside. Wade Smith, a walking testament to the outstanding depth of this club, fired in 10 points to help lock up the win. Next on the horizon was a battle with interstate rival Marshall in the Charleston Civic Center. The record-setting crowd saw a tight, hard-driving contest until WVU put this one away in the final minutes. Darrell Prue fired in a season-high 22 points to lead the Mountaineers. Steve Berger and Herbie Brooks teamed up for 31 to keep this top 20 ball club in the winning groove. After sweeping the four-game road trip, West Virginia returned to a gigantic welcome home party in the Coliseum. This team rewarded that sold-out crowd with a dominating performance over Penn State. All five starters hit for double figures as WVU reached the century mark for the third time this season. Center Ray Foster was perfect that day, hitting every field goal and foul shot he took. Steve Berger also had a perfect game, shooting 100% from the floor and foul line. The junior dynamo also hit an incredible 4-for-4 from three-point distance. It was one of those glorious days when nothing could go wrong.
We keyed on Penn State because we knew it was going to be a hard game. And the first shot I took was a three-pointer, but it hit, you know, I took it from the top of the key and went off the glass. And I kind of, you know, snickered with myself and Herbie. So, I don't know, I just start from then on. I didn't think we the team could do anything wrong, and, you know, we did it.
After two more road wins over St. Bonnie and UMass, West Virginia crunched Rhode Island in the Coliseum. Chris Brooks, who has the highest career field goal percentage in Mountaineer history, led the way with 22 points. Ray Foster, who seemed to get better with every outing, followed with 17. Few teams win more than 20 games in a season. West Virginia had now won 21 games in a row and shot up to number 11 in the polls. In the home finale against St. Joseph's, Berger and Little Brooks each hit for 14 points to lead the Golden Blue attack. The streak had ballooned to 22 games. And to this talented club, not winning seemed downright preposterous.
I didn't think that we could lose. Going into each game, I'd be like, there's no way we're going to lose this game. And we was in the locker room. We were loose before the games, after the games, traveling to the games. It was a really special moment for us to go through that win streak. And, you know, instilled, I think that's going to help all of us out in our careers after basketball.
However, all glory is fleeting. After such a spectacular streak of success, West Virginia finally had an off night. Against Temple in Philadelphia, a flat Mountaineer squad came up short and lost their first league game of the season. The streak had ended, but this team fought through that setback and rebounded against Penn State in the last game of the regular season. Four starters hit for double figures in the 10-point win. Big Ray Foster dominated the contest and poured in 15 points. At 24-3, this team stood alone at the top of the pyramid as the regular season champions of the Atlantic 10 Conference. The success continued in the league tournament as 18 points from Herbie Brooks led the way over St. Joseph's in the first round game. 13 points each from Steve Berger and Big Brooks helped seal the 20-point victory and set up a semifinal game against Penn State. However, the third time was not a charm against the Nittany Lions. Penn State overwhelmed and exhausted Mountaineer Ball Club and knocked them from the tournament. But this is not the end of our tale. Greensboro, North Carolina would be the next stop for this team as the NCAA selection committee awarded West Virginia with an at-large bid. The first-round opponent would be a tough Tennessee squad. In pregame preparations, Gale Catlett knew a war of a ballgame loomed on the horizon. But he also knew his cadre of battle-tested warriors were up to the task.
We're going to try to line up and just get after him a little bit tomorrow if we can. And I'm sure he's going to do the same thing to us. So it should be a fun game to watch. We both average about the same amount of points. I think they average about 84. We're about 80. I hope that we average as many as we've been averaging all year, and I hope we give up as many we've been giving up all year. We've been averaging about 80, giving up 66. I hope it happens tomorrow.
A fired-up West Virginia team stormed into the Greensboro Coliseum and overwhelmed Tennessee. Ray Foster controlled the tempo inside, and Herbie Brooks had a sparkling day from the perimeter. The Mountaineer defense throttled the Volunteer attack, holding them to only 29% from the floor in the first half. In the second stanza, WVU continued to stretch the lead and won this game by 16 points. Like Gail Catlett had hoped for, West Virginia had a field goal percentage of nearly 62% while limiting Tennessee to less than 38. It was a stellar performance that earned high praise from the Top Gun.
But I'm pleased that we did some of the things that this team has done all year long. This is the best defensive club I've coached in my 11 years at West Virginia, and pretty close being the best offensive club. But there have been very few clubs I've been around in 26 years that could hold people under 40% from the field and shoot over 50% themselves. That's a unique statistic right there.
Next, West Virginia faced Duke and Player of the Year, Danny Ferry. By all reason, WVU was expected to fall quietly to the powerhouse Blue Devils. But this was a gutsy team that had defied conventional wisdom all season long. West Virginia gave Duke all it could handle before falling prey to crippling early foul trouble and lost by 7 points. Despite the loss, this was not a time for remorse, but a time to celebrate a 26-5 season as the incredible accomplishment that it was. For Gail Catlett, this may have been the most rewarding team he has ever coached. It was a team that nearly always found a way to win. But that incredible record was, more than anything, a testament to the faith and determination of the winningest coach in the history of West Virginia basketball. Gail Catlett willed this team to believe in itself, to believe that success was contagious, and to believe that winning extended beyond the boundaries of basketball. The lessons taught by this man will influence these young lives forever.
I have the greatest respect in the world for Coach Catlett, on and off the court. I think he's a great coach, first of all. He's instilled a lot of things into me on the basketball court that I know a lot of people wouldn't have. And off the court, the thing that I respect about him most is he's worried about us as people instead of just basketball players. Coming here, he works hard and stresses to everyone that they get their education because there's life after basketball, and that's a great quality for him to be concerned about our lives after basketball.
One thing that made this club successful was its senior leadership. Darryl Prue, the 6'7 forward with the soft touch, will be remembered as one of the most accurate shooters in Mountaineer history. Herbie Brooks, this year's leading scorer, will be sorely missed after his 4 years of consistent play at guard. Ray Foster, with just a year of eligibility as a Mountaineer, adjusted quickly and was an anchor in the middle. And Wade Smith overcame the long odds of a deep bench to become a consistent scorer and dependable sixth man. These four will leave a void that will be filled by talented veterans and newcomers alike. And come next season, they too will be molded into the West Virginia tradition of excellence. The WVU basketball highlights have been presented by Key Centurion Bank Shares. This has been a Mountaineer Sports Network presentation.